Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting in 2022 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are we all agreed? We're all agreed. The next item on our agenda is to take evidence on the impact of the Community Empowerment Act on allotments and community food growing. This is the last of 3 evidence sessions the committee is holding during its current inquiry. We will be discussing this topic today with a panel of witnesses who each submitted written responses to our call for views last month. They represent allotments, community groups and food growing. Our witnesses today are Karen Birch, who's the co-founder and chair of Abundant Borders, Ian Welsh, who is an allotment user, Roseanne Wood from the Trenent Allotment Association, and Marie de la Tour, who's the chair of Notnagale Limited. And I welcome all our witnesses to the meeting today. Karen, Ian and Maria are joining us remotely. And for the record, I'd like to highlight that as an MSP, I've recently been supporting Notnagale Limited in using the Community Empowerment Act to transfer land from the Scottish Government. It would be helpful if members could direct their questions to a specific witness where possible, although I will be happy to bring others in who wish to contribute. And if witnesses do wish to comment, please indicate your desire to do so to me or the clerk, and I'll bring you in at an appropriate point. And Karen, Ian and Maria, if you could indicate that you wish to come in, please type an R in the chat function in BlueJeans. And I'll now open up the session to questions from members, and I'll begin with the first question. So the kind of first theme is around costs and benefits. I'd like to open up with a broad question about the barriers to accessing allotments. Throughout the evidence sessions and site visits, we've seen the challenges allotment owners and associations have faced and overcome. And likewise, we've heard about challenges faced by local authorities in providing allotments. Identifying these barriers to access is a crucially important part of this post-legislative scrutiny that the committee is undertaking. And given this, I'm keen to hear your experiences of what the main barriers in accessing allotments and community growing spaces are. And I would like to start with Ian, and then I'll go to Roseanne. Ian.
Hello. Good morning. My focus is really around what's happening in the cities. From what I can gather, the current waiting list, Glasgow and Edinburgh and Fife, probably amount to something like 10,000, which is significantly more than the number of plots that are actually available in those places. And Fife has taken a proactive approach for a number of years now, and as such have increased the number of plots that they had from 2007. Edinburgh and Glasgow have done a certain amount, but they're not anywhere near, they are, they're past the trigger points in terms of the legislation. One of the problems is that the actual trigger point of when the number of applicants reaches more than 50% of the plots that a council operates was to be delayed by 8 years, but the actual trigger point for that is 8 years after regulations have been set. Regulations were meant to be set in 2020. As I understand, in Glasgow, they are still yet to be agreed and introduced. So that adds a further delay into the process.
Out of curiosity, do you have an understanding of why that delay was put into the legislation?
Well, I was formerly a president of the Scottish Allotments and Garden Society. I was involved with other committee members in negotiating with Scottish Government over Part 9 and the detail in it. And then we became part of the tripartite group, which was 4 representatives from Scottish Allotments and 4 council representatives, namely Glasgow, Edinburgh, North Ayrshire and Fife, and officials from Scottish Government. At the time, we thought that 8 years would be a reasonable time for councils to be to prepare, because there's a clear implication for costs. And as we all know, councils have been for many years struggling to meet costs. I myself recently retired from a ground services operation or parks operation, so that often is connected to allotments. We know what the budget situations were, and that creating new sites obviously requires funding. The resource that councils may have is land. The issue is often finding the funds to develop it. There has been success in terms of a lot of other sites being created, mainly in rural council areas. So in 2007, we published this document, a survey of where Scotland's allotments were. There was 6,500 then. It coincided with an upsurge in interest from people looking to have allotments in their area. In some cases, like a place like Langham down in the Borders, there weren't any and hadn't been any for many years. These groups became constituted and then negotiated either with the council or other landowners, often obtaining funds from Loss of Resources, Climate Challenge Fund, to create the infrastructure needed to create these sites. And so there's probably somewhere around another 2,000 plots being created since 2007 as a result of that kind of action. The problem in the cities is that people submit their name onto a waiting list. That waiting list may be held by the council. It may be held by self-managed sites on council land, or it may be held in the case of my site, which is a completely independent one. And people simply languish there until such times as an association or the council is able to offer them a vacant plot. And my own site now, which has 50 plots, has a waiting list, I understand, of around 130. The kind of turnover we've experienced in recent years would indicate that it could take 5 years just simply to work our way through perhaps the first 30 or so people on that list. So it's very difficult for any association, be they independent or operating, managing the site on behalf of a council, to actually take forward the issue of creating a new site or representing the people that are on the waiting list. The problem is that the people on the waiting lists are not necessarily members of any organisation. They're simply individuals waiting for a letter to appear offering them a plot. And in many instances, that could amount to many years.
Thank you very much for that. So that's interesting to hear that there was a desire for the 8 years to allow councils to prepare, and then in the meantime we've had things like COVID that have brought that upsurge, even more desire for people to get their patch for growing food. Roseanne, what's your experience in Trenent? Is it similar? Are there other things going on there?
Well, we have 34 plots, which is we have 6 community plots and the rest are all individual plots. Our waiting list is currently at 34. Which does seem a lot, but there's only 9 that haven't been offered a plot. We give people the chance that if you're offered a plot and can't take it for some reason, you can go back on, but you go back down the bottom. So we keep these people on. If you're offered once and don't reply, we'll put you to the bottom of the list, and if you don't reply twice, then you're off the list. We didn't have any, just before COVID, we actually had nobody waiting for a plot. But obviously COVID has just sent it through the roof. We operate ourselves. It used to be the council, but they don't have the manpower. The chap retired, and so they set up the association. So we do it ourselves. We do everything. We do the allocating, the keeping up with the making sure the plots are looked after. We're actually, I know it says 50% of plots, but ours, as I say, it's not too bad. So it is about 2 years. The person at the top has been waiting for 2 years now. Likelihood of people giving up, not since COVID. I think people have just cherished them. And yeah, but I know in Musselburgh, they have closed their waiting list. They have 64 plots and they closed it when it got over 100. And I think their waiting time is about 10 years. There's frequently complaints in the paper, but there's nothing they can do. But I know they've now started to maybe half their plots, which I believe we have what's called half plots, but it's manageable. Nobody there thinks they should have a bigger plot, and some people do struggle.
Thank you. Maria, you wanted to come in.
Hello, thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to be here. I think I wanted to raise a different issue of a different barrier in sort of, we're based in Inverness where there is only two allotment sites. One has 60 spaces and the other one has 30 spaces. The larger one is rented from Highland Council, while the other one is rented from a private developer in a short-term lease. And Inverness has about 51,000 inhabitants. So we are a growing city. And I think I would highlight that a key issue is access to land for these allotments and community growing spaces to be set off. Our experience as a community group that has been looking to acquire a site that is already owned by the Scottish Government and is part of the Scottish Bull Farm is that we've faced an incredible number of barriers to try and develop the project. So I do think there is an issue there that is not just about the running of the existing allotment sites, but how we ensure that access to land is facilitated to make sure that we are able to provide the sites and as we move forward and we've got this community basis.
Thank you for that. And does Karen, do you want to come in?
Yes, I think we look at it in a different way. I think we've heard three times already with looking at allotment plots. It's a case of finding quite a large piece of land, because if a council is looking for a site, it's probably looking for a sufficient piece of land for maybe put on 20 allotments as a minimum. That's quite a large piece of land, and it's also very resource intensive to run an allotment, because everybody wants a shed, everybody wants their own area to store. There's also then a lot of community pathways to access all the different allotments. So having an allotment site is actually quite a big ask. We look at things very differently, and in creating community gardens. So that means there isn't so much of a need for a massive amount of space in order to satisfy the food growing ambitions of a larger number of people. So if you have an allotment site for 20 people, that is quite a big piece of land. We have community garden spaces that are on less than an acre, and we would maybe have 20 people who are able to grow food collectively on that piece of land. Taking that approach, we're in the Scottish Borders, just to emphasise that, we haven't had any difficulty at all in accessing pieces of land in order to do community food growing. That's been through the council, through their establishment of their green spaces team, where the council are looking to make more and more pieces of land available. But the biggest success has been through housing associations, because having a making facility for community growing space satisfied the need of their tenants, but also it builds community within a particular area, because people are involved in keeping a part of, for example, a housing development nice and tidy as a community recreational space as well as a food growing space. So as I say, that we, yeah, just despite the title of the consultation on the committee, we don't have a huge amount say about allotments, but we do have quite a different approach to availability of green spaces and possibilities of food growing within communities.
Thanks, Karen. That's great to hear your perspective and your innovation there in looking at what might be a community growing space. And so, but it does seem to be that tension, from just what everyone has said, it seems to be the tension does seem to happen in the urban, in our cities, where there's not so much growing space. Maria, you already kind of preempted my second question, which was around the kind of support and facilitation coming from the Scottish Government and local authorities. But maybe I could just pick up with the same kind of theme with Karen and then maybe Ian around what we think that local authorities and the Scottish Government could do to better support allotments and community growing spaces. Karen, do you want to come in on that?
Yes, I'm happy to go first on that. I think as part of the food growing strategy that the Scottish Borders Council had to create as part of the this overall bill, what they actually came up with wasn't, in our opinion, a food growing strategy, but it did become quite a comprehensive community food growing strategy. And as part of that, they have now created a community food growers network and also a green spaces team looking at how we can make that space available. So there are still in the more, I don't think anywhere in the borders could really be described as an urban area, but there are waiting lists in places like Hoyk and Galla Shields, as I understand it, sort of where there's sort of population centres. But there is more and more community space to get people involved. So I think we need to try and be creative in the way we look at food growing and the way we actually involve people. So if we have, for example, the community food growing site that we first established in Eimer is a half plot on the allotment. So we have five people growing food on that small plot in Eimer. So that has helped people who are on the waiting list. It's also helped people who maybe aren't sure about taking on an allotment space. So it's meant that we have been able to give them the skills and the help them build that confidence before they take on a larger space. It's also meant that people haven't dropped off the waiting list so readily because they have had engagement. And as a result of that, we've now taken on a much bigger community growing space just out with the allotments in Eimer. Again, it will act as a true community growing space with volunteers all doing that and supporting the community growing. But it will also be a training centre for people who still want to have their own space and want it to grow things in their own way. So I think we can be creative of blending community growing spaces because even on there is a waiting list in Eimer for allotments, but there are also overgrown spaces where people aren't able to maintain the space and the community. You know, there has to be something within the allotment society to give people the opportunity to be able to learn and make good and not expect something to be perfect in the first year. So that, you know, it's maybe 3 or 4 years before somebody then gives up that plot. Whereas if we can be creative about helping people who think they want an allotment get the skills to be able to grow their own food, then it also improves the success of the allotmenteers themselves.
Okay, yeah, thanks for that. Yeah, so that's a clear theme that has been coming through around the whole piece of getting people skilled up. Ian, do you have any thoughts around what the local authorities and Scottish Government need to do to be better facilitators?
So can I just check, can you hear me clearly?
Can hear you fine.
Well, that's fine, thank you. Right, well, direct answer to that in terms of the waiting lists in our cities is finding a way to communicate more directly with the people on the waiting lists. I know from the involvement I've had in the past, both the Scottish Allotments, the Glasgow Allotment Forum, there are concerns often with site secretaries about contravening anything to do with data protection by passing names on to other organisations or whatever. But somebody's got to actually try and find a way to alert the people on the waiting lists, particularly in a site like mine. Now, we could choose to do that, write to them and say, you're sort of number 41 on our list of 130. It is unlikely we can offer you a plot in a reasonably meaningful period of time. What you need to do is get together with other like-minded people, form yourself into an identifiable group, and identify yourself with some sort of location. Now, it's interesting, Eyemouth was mentioned. Eyemouth was one of the self-start groups that I alluded to that occurred after 2005. It's been going for at least 10 or more years now. And so they started from scratch, from nothing, and done it that way. They've done it before the legislation came into play. And so there are other issues that need clarifying to do with the status of many allotment associations, which is usually that of an unincorporated association. Perhaps there may be an opportunity later in the proceedings to come back to that. But the main thing is to, where these large waiting lists occur, is to find some way of encouraging people to empower themselves and make use of the legislation, because they don't really know or understand what the situation is that they are currently in.
Thanks for that. Yes, and a really good point that, you know, we can actually, yeah, how do we kind of get people together so they can empower themselves? Maria, you wanted to come back in?
Yes, and perhaps that follows quite well with the last comments, really. I think I just wanted to add a little bit in relation to what I said earlier on. I think local authorities do have a lot of pressure now, and it's difficult for them to run allotment sites, but they can play quite a key role in terms of facilitating the process of groups being able to acquire land, in particular brokering relations with other public organisations. And perhaps one of the gaps that the legislation has is that it only covers local authorities and doesn't really extend to other public organisations that might hold land as well, and that could be could provide for food growing, and I think, you know, that's perhaps an area that could be improved. I think in our case it is quite difficult to believe that in a Scottish government owned bull farm that is in the sort of middle of Inverness, and one would have thought that has obviously the scope to provide for the community that it's there should be the scope to collaborate closely with the community that lives there. We have faced so many barriers in terms of being able to take the project forward, and I think that that is partly due to a culture really of working more closely, in terms of working closely with the community. And I think that's another important point to put across, that we need a culture that really is about collaborating with communities to help them take forward these projects, that will help as well create more spaces that provide for allotments and food growing and help resolve some of these waiting lists we have. Thank you.
Thank you. Roseanne, do you want to come in on this at all?
Yeah, we are quite lucky in Trinane. I've just realised actually, Beth, we obviously have 6 community plots, and the food bank has one. They've just recently taken it on, and also an area called Home Start, which is for young families who are struggling. So they have the allotment plot, but they're also based in one of the local schools who has a big garden, and most of the schools in Trinane now have a big garden where they're growing stuff. So they ask Home Start or us for help. We also help Roots and Fruits, East Lothian Roots and Fruits. It's a co-op. They've recently just got a garden, so they're going to do that. So we're all collaborating with each other, which I think, listening to people, it is a bit sort of, unique, but you know, we've also got Ormiston Grove that we help, and there's a community garden down in Trunnane. So if some people say, how long do I have to wait? But you can try Ormiston Groves because it's more small sort of raised beds you can get, or you can go to the community garden where I think you can go for a couple hours every week. You don't actually have your own plot, but you can help grow things. So we do sort of have lots of things that everybody's involved with and keep in touch. So we're actually quite lucky in Trunnane.
Great. Thanks very much. I'm now going to move on to a new theme that Miles Briggs is going to introduce.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us. And you've touched upon a lot of the questions I wanted to ask, but I wanted to return to some more detail with regards to auditing of current plots. And just wondered, it was something actually you mentioned, Ian, in terms of splitting plots. I wondered to what extent the bill has meant councils have done that sort of work to look at how we really utilise the maximum capacity which is currently there, and if you think that's been done, or if basically we've just developed, you know, waiting lists. So I'll maybe bring you back in, Ian, on that.
Right, thank you. Well, I'm not absolutely up to speed in current situations. I have spoken to representatives of GAF and the Edinburgh Federation recently, just to glean a little bit about what's currently going on. I think there has been attempts in some instances to have plots. My own site done it a few years ago, and then found that the other people coming in wanted to recombine them. Our plots are round about 200 square metres, and nearly all of them have a hut and or glass house on them. Sometimes that can make it a bit difficult to split. I'll better stick to your question. One of the issues really is that you can have plots, but really all you're doing is cramming more people onto the same amount of land. The size of the allotment, which we tried to get over in the legislation, was one that was established at the end of the First World War, as the size of a piece of ground that would enable a household group of four people to provide themselves with most of their needs in terms of fruit and vegetables. It could be in the current climate, and in the one that we may be moving into in the near future, that need remains as relevant now as it did then. The other benefits that come from an allotment, social interaction, better diet, meeting people, effects on people's mental health, etc. Again, they will all come from being involved in something that uses up a reasonable amount of a person's time. Looking after a few square metres will have benefits for people. For many people, it might be all they require. But in terms of an allotment, it won't produce the amount of food that a 200 square metre or thereabouts plot of ground would do. Sorry, I don't know whether that answers the question.
No, that's helpful. Does anyone else want to come on that point?
I can. We were taking on the allotments, the association set up, we had a chairperson, but he couldn't do it because it was a lot of work involved. And nobody wanted to do it, so they asked me to take it on. And I said, only if I have the right to get rid of neglected plots. And they did. And thankfully, the council supported us because we had about 8 neglected plots and it was horrendous. I had one beside me for 8 years that was never taken care of. And that's what we do. We're quite strict with them. We have 2 inspections every year. One is in June, so if there's 2 plots I know already that are neglected, so they'll be given 28 days to start doing work in it. We're not wanting it perfect, but we want the weeds cut down. And if they don't, they've got a further 2 weeks and then they're evicted. And we have done that. Because it's only fair because we have a big waiting list, and it's not fair for if you're growing things to have a neglected plot beside you because it doesn't help. But I think that is quite unusual that we are very much so. We do evict people.
Yep.
Karen, you'd like to come in as well.
I just want to go back to the what I said before, really, which is that I think we do need to be much more creative, because as Ian was saying, a lot of the thinking about the size of allotments and why people have an allotment relates to post-First World War and people growing a sustainable plot for growing fruit and veg for the whole family. That in our experience of talking to people at allotments and we're supporting a couple of blended sites, is that's no longer what people are doing with the allotment, and that's no longer what that might not be their main driver for having an allotment site. So I think that we need to be more creative about the size of site. And again, as Ian said, everybody will use some of the site for a glass house and some seating area. So again, within, I think we need to be thinking creatively about that, because there's a lot of non-food growing space within allotments. So I think we'd be able to let people have more growing space if, for example, you were to say, well, you could, there's a community glass house or there's a community tool storage area. And then maybe half a plot would be sufficient, because you wouldn't have the need to put a shed on your half plot. So I think it's just going back to, it's probably out with the scope of the discussions, and I apologise if I'm taking the discussion in a slightly random direction, but I think a lot of the thinking on allotments goes back a long way, and I think we do need to be more creative in thinking about these growing spaces in order to tackle both neglected plots and waiting lists.
Thanks for that, Karen. No, it's a good point, and we've seen communal composting areas, for example, which has helped to try to prevent that, replication of everyone having a composting space on their allotment. In terms of other parts of the 2015 Act being used, do you have any examples, for example, around common good land now being facilitated, and potentially for what you were touching upon earlier, Karen, to provide for those starter smaller plots, raised beds, to make sure that people kind of really want to do this and then can be transitioned into half a plot or a full plot? Has the Act helped to develop that in any way?
I can't really sort of answer that directly. I can only really talk from sort of recent experience post food growing strategy within the Scottish Borders, in that there is a renewed determination to make pieces of land available and to have that mapping exercise of what land is there, of what size, what facilities already exist on the land, and what the cost would be in bringing that into to community use and community ownership. So certainly that has made a recent difference down here. And as I mentioned before, engagement with the housing associations, because they are also major landowners, that has been very productive down here for the creation of small spaces, because again, in the rural community, it's difficult for people to get to a larger site often. So it's fine if you're in somewhere like Hoyk where you can walk to allotment, but if you have somewhere in a more rural community, you're not going to get a big allotment site built in here where I live in Weston. There isn't sufficient people for the site to be here for an allotment site. So we're looking for sort of smaller pieces of ground for to be actually part of the community, rather than having to have that travel to a central site in Eyemouth or where have you. So it has made a difference in thinking, certainly.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to come in on that?
I know Ormiston Grows, that they're sort of like, I do send people there, and they do have raised beds, and you've got different size of raised beds. Problem being is it's not very secure. Mm. I've never been there. I don't know where it is, but apparently it's beside a big walkway, and there's no security. So I do direct people there if they can get on, and some people are desperate, but there's nothing I can do.
Yeah.
to make them go up the waiting list. So.
And Maria, you wanted to come in as well.
Yes, I mean, in November next week, we have examples of some community spaces that are being used by Inverness Incredible Edible to grow sort of small areas of food growing in town centre areas. But one key thing I wanted to bring up is that I think one thing that is quite critical for allotments is thinking about the quality of the land. One of the reasons we put forward Norton Gael as a community growing area is because it was a field that was already used for growing vegetables and was really good land for that. So not all common good land may be appropriate, and I think it's important that we sort of think of using sites that are good for growing food for allotment and community growing. So it's maybe a key point that I would bring up. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Yes, I think that's a really important point. If we've got good land, let's grow food on it. So we're going to move on to another theme. Mark, I don't know if you've still got some other questions around the waiting list and trigger points.
Yep. Thanks, Kevin. My questions are around waiting lists and demand and communication between authorities and on those waiting lists. And we've had quite a bit of discussion on that so far. But just to ask generally, and I think I probably know the answer from earlier discussion, what is demand like and what roughly how many people are on waiting lists in your area, and how has that changed since the 2015 Act? I've come to Roseanne first.
I've only been doing the waiting lists, 4 years now. So I couldn't tell you how it has been then. It was a bit of a guddle, the waiting list, because when I actually got to find the waiting list I was given had people that had left years ago. So I don't actually know from there, but since COVID, we've got 9 new people and we've probably allocated 4 plots since COVID, which we usually have quite a turnover every year, but not since COVID, because I think there are quite, it was places for people to go to. So.
Okay, any of the participants online like to come in there?
Maria.
Yeah, I'm aware that in Inverness there is about 80 waiting for in Hawthorne, and Blackthorne, the smallest site, has closed their waiting list because they can't cope with any of the requests. Our own investigations were then when we did a community survey about a year and a half or 2 years ago, we had about 165 people expressing an interest, and that was just from a survey in 1 month. And we know that with the pandemic, the demand has increased, so there are, you say, you know, hundreds of people waiting to have an allotment, at least in our area that we're aware of. Thank you.
Thank you. And is there anyone else who would like to come in on this question? Ian.
This is one of the things I was checking up on to update the figures that I had stated in my submission. Edinburgh's current waiting list, I understand, is 5,496. I know from my involvement with SAG's committee going back 3-4 years, that's more than doubled. Glasgow, it's a bit more difficult because it may be they decide to only take account of local authority sites. Now, there's apparently 13 sites that had responded at the end of April, registering 1,331 applications. 8 sites had still to respond, so that was 21. But then there's another 12 sites that are private, independent, like my own. So the likely waiting list for Glasgow is 1,800 plus. We do not know how many people on our list of 130 have their names on the council list. There is another independent site, that's at Home League Gardens in Kirkcart, a quarter of a mile from us. Equally, many of the people that are on our list may be on their list. this is always quoted as an unknown factor. It shouldn't be the reason for delaying doing something. The process of engaging with people, getting them involved, getting them to go through the process themselves to get a site, that has an effect of whittling out to some extent the people who may decide it's not for them. And eventually, again, when people get onto sites, as has been indicated from what seems to have happened at Eyemouth, because encapsulated in this is the relationship between the people of Scotland and the land of Scotland, and in particular, anything to do with working the land. We have become disengaged from that over a number of generations. And so all these other issues about people not really understanding where food comes from and how it is produced, simply because they think it all comes out the supermarket. And that's where getting more people involved in growing can help address those issues.
Okay, I wanted to touch on communication with people on waiting lists as well, and what work local authorities can do perhaps to identify duplicate places on waiting lists. And Ian, you touched on data protection issues, but I mean, there are ways around everything. If allotment associations ask the members for permission to share the data, do you think there's a bigger role for local authorities to essentially have a comprehensive local authority level waiting lists, so that with the permission of the individual applicants, that councils can then actually start the coordination of those on waiting lists to encourage them to incorporate themselves, perhaps looking at particular sites and particular parts of the authority where authorities own land? It doesn't seem to me to be beyond the impossible to do something like that and have local authority coordinated waiting lists, as long as people are given their permission to share the data. Perhaps come to Ian first.
Well, a few years ago, going back to about 2005, is when Glasgow Allotment Forum started, and that changed the relationship between the plot holders and the council. What came out of that was the appointment of an allotment officer, and a reasonably early stage of that, we had at the time, because I was treasurer of my own association, so I had access to the waiting list, and I counted up how many we had. I think it was about 50 then, and I selected information to give to the allotment officer. I gave him it in the form of, we have 50 people on our waiting list, 10 of them are in G42, 8 of them are in G43, etc. And I think that helped him to decide, looking in terms of that bit of the postcode, where people were, that it justified the reopening of a site at Crawfoot in Glasgow. So it's one way of perhaps doing it. But that's passing it on to someone who's going to take it forward and implement it. I fear in some situations the only way it's going to be implemented is by people taking action themselves. Community empowerment. It's what the legislation is supposed to be about.
Thanks, Kimina.
Great. Thanks, Ian. I really love your contributions. I love what you said earlier about the importance of allotments being about the relationship between people of Scotland and the land of Scotland, and not just the land, but working the land. And I think there's some truth that there. I think we're aware of that in the committee. I'm going to move on to bring in questions from Willie Coffey, who's joining us online.
Thanks, Ariane, and good morning to everybody in the panel. Before I ask a few questions about guidance on the Act and the 250 metres, on whether people that are on the waiting, not participating in other examples like community garden spaces and so on. The reason I ask you that is that East Ayrshire doesn't have any allotments, they tell me, and they don't have anybody applying. But there are a number of examples of community gardens spaces here, there and everywhere. So by and large, do you think that the people that are on the list, Ian, you mentioned 5,400 or so in Edinburgh and maybe 1,800 in Glasgow, are they participating by other means or are they just not able to do so at all? What do you think? What's the picture?
Evidence one way or the other. And the basic thing you've got to assume is that if someone applies for an allotment, it is an allotment they want. But then there is room for all sorts of misunderstandings there. I mean, I've been aware for many years watching television programmes and news bulletins, the term allotment is used, and then what is being described or presented visually isn't necessarily an allotment. I don't think I understood it myself when I took on my plot back in 1976. It's been a long learning curve. And that's the problem. Unless you personally know people, you don't necessarily know what they may already be involved in. You've got to assume that they have some basic understanding of what an allotment is. I didn't know about the definitions of it and all the bits of legislation that used to be behind it. But when I went to the site responding to the letter I had inviting me to come and be offered an allotment, when I walked into the site, what I saw was what I expected an allotment to be. It wasn't a surprise to me. When the previous Local Government Regeneration Committee took evidence from us, as part of that process, some of the MSPs came to Glasgow and visited a number of sites, including a housing association site in Govan. And they visited my site. And we were fortunate we had two women members who gave them testimony at that meeting. And what they said was they'd come in, and they'd only had their plots certainly less than 5 years at that point. And they came in and they said, oh, we thought these plots looked really big and that we weren't going to be able to court them. Now we've reached a stage where we reckon we don't have enough ground to grow everything we want to grow. And those two ladies are still there with their families. They have families, so they make use of what's available to them. It's very difficult to say until you can find a way to communicate directly with the people on these waiting lists. It is different in the city. The situations that happened in places like Eyemouth and indeed in Inverness, going back again to the early 2000s, was that people contacted us in Scottish Allotments, or they contacted what was the then Allotment Regeneration Initiative that I volunteered with, and they would say, oh, we're looking for an allotment, what do we do? And we'd explain the basic processes that then was, that it basically amounted to find other like-minded people, form yourselves into a cohesive group. Mm-hmm. Now, there's something I hope will come up later on in our discussions about what the nature of that organisation should be. It tended to be just an unincorporated association then, but there's things perhaps in the legislation, and I think in the interpretation of it, it would appear in Glasgow, that seem to require that the groups have to be more than just an unincorporated association.
Okay. Thanks very much for that, Ian. Karen, are you coming in, or is it Maria?
Yes, I have a couple of thoughts to add to this question, really. I mean, I should probably say as a bit of background that our organisation, Canady, has been, we started 6 years ago and formed as a company 2 years ago. So we have been dealing with allotment, with members and allotment requests for a while, really. And I think one thing that I sort of feel it's transmitted to us is the frustration that many people have because they're not able to get hold of an allotment, really. For some, it's really something they are quite desperate. They might not have a garden or any other space. And it's something that for us as an organisation that has been, sort of working on this for a while, it is quite disappointing that we're not able to tell, give them a timeline of when they will be able to access a site. But there is really a real desire, I think, from many people to get hold of that land. And they might be doing, some might decide to do other activities, get involved in other things. But certainly we know from the feedback we get that some people really feel it quite a lot, that gap really. And the other thing I was going to bring up, that's something slightly different, is that one of our experiences is that we've had a lot of organisations that have approached us to use sites, to use, to rent a plot. And it's not just individuals, but we've been approached and actually organisations have like Action for Children, homelessness have got in touch because they want to a plot they can use for their clients and also for their volunteers. And it's been a new phenomenon that we hadn't sort of realised, the strong demand there is from these organisations. And since COVID in particular, they feel that outdoor spaces are more safe and the opportunities that you've got for food, for food growing in terms of, developing skills for people that enable them to cope better with life and with mental health, with other sets of issues and perhaps even develop their self-confidence, and also in terms of giving people access to food in the case of families that haven't got as much, then it's quite important. So I think I would say, that there is a real gap there that is felt by many.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Mark. Yeah. Karen?
Pretty much I'm agreeing and echoing what Maria said. I think she's covered most of what I was going to say. I think it's going back to what Ian said about people being on a waiting list. I think we need to look a little bit more closely as why people are on the waiting list, what they think they want with an allotment. As Ian's experience was that when he went and was shown the site, it was exactly what he was expecting and he knew exactly what to do with it. I think there are people who have come through sort of community garden experience who have been on the waiting list and they haven't actually wanted an allotment as such. They've wanted an opportunity to grow their own food, or they've wanted an opportunity to be involved in something that they view to be climate friendly, or they've wanted an opportunity just to be in an outdoor space, as Maria said. So I think that we could maybe do a little bit more work to unpick what people think, because I think because the allotment model is so well developed and so the word allotment is so well known, and if you see sort of programmes on the TV, they're talking about allotments and allotment spaces. That might be that people think that that's their only option. So if they're looking for somewhere to get out of their flat, well, I need an allotment. It might be that they actually just need some outdoor space, as Maria was saying, to be able to meet other people in a safe post-COVID way. So I think that there may well be some work done to there to see that, do people actually want an allotment? That might feed into why there are so many plots that then do become neglected. That people, what they thought they wanted wasn't actually what they wanted. So there may be something around that. So yeah, really just echoing what Maria was saying.
Great, thanks very much, Karen. Could I ask you just briefly for a response to the 250 square metre issue? I think, Roseanne, you talked about it earlier. Does there need to be flexibility around that? Do local authorities have to allocate 250 square metres, or could we be more flexible about this to give people some kind of entry level into it that is perhaps easier to manage, and it might enable us to allocate smaller allotment sizes and spaces to people and get these waiting lists down? So just what are your views briefly on the 250 square metre thing that's in the legislation? Should we be more flexible around that? Maybe start with Roseanne.
Nobody in our allotment thinks that their plot is too small. And, well, I'm only a family of two, but everybody has excess stuff, and that all gets given away to the local food co-op. So we everybody more than enough. There's families of four, there's families of more, and they grow enough to do them. So I think the size is good, because if not, then that meant there would only have been 13 individual plots and three community ones, and that's nothing. Whereas now we do have a decent amount, and yeah, I think the half plots are a good way to go. And as I said, Musselburgh have started doing that to get down their waiting list. So yeah, I think there should be some flexibility there.
Okay, thanks for that.
Oh, sorry, I didn't quite catch that. Right. The size that was put in the legislation was a long and hard fight. And we're trying to make it clear it's there as a reference size, not a compulsory one. Because my own experience from being involved with the Allotment Regeneration Initiative and going around sites then, and then also meeting people in places where they were wanting to set up new sites, was that the existing stock of allotments, the 6,500, most of them were not all exactly the same size and aren't now. They're whatever size fitted best into a piece of ground to accommodate the number of people that wanted to have a plot. And so we certainly want existing sites to be redesigned to make them all 250 square metres. It is simply that yardstick of, if your aim is to produce enough food and vegetables to make a meaningful impact in sustaining a family, a household, then you need something like that. Their concern was that if it got watered down too much, then that space that's in the middle of those desks you're currently sitting at, if that was the sort of size that was going to be an allotment, that's what all allotments would end up being, and they wouldn't then be achieving the objective they're meant to be doing. Albeit that there is all these other issues tied up in it. There is no doubt there is value from people having access to a smaller space. It lets them start off and it lets them find out, is this for them, or is the small 10, 20 square metres all they need for what they want to do? But those sort of spaces are not allotments. They're not always defined in the legislation, and they are not protected by the legislation. And that is why, by 2007, there was only 6,500 plots left in Scotland, probably about 10% of what there had been after the war, because there was no protection or no perceived protection.
Many thanks for that, Ian. Just a final comment from Karen and maybe Maria on the 250 square metres issue.
Yeah, I agree with Ian. It does need to be have something that's protection to say that's what an allotment is, because that's sort of the feeling that is the amount of space that needs to fulfil that purpose of growing food for a family of four. So that, I think there really does need to be protection around that, so that, as was said before, you know, people who successfully manage that size of plot and are successfully growing food for their families on that size of plot does need to be protected. But we do need to be more creative in finding other ways, maybe other names. So when the council create an allotment plot, they also create smaller spaces that can be called something different, and they also create a community space within that, so we can have that flow through of people, because not everybody's motivation for having an allotment size plot is to grow food for a family of four.
Thank you very much, Carl. And last word maybe, Maria, please.
Yes, we've had some designs. We have a plan design, and based really our feedback was based, and designs were based on the feedback we received survey. Person of interest, quite a range of sizes, and even our large plots that we have planned would be smaller than 20 by 10 metres, 10 by 10 and 10 by 5 metres. So I think, you know, although I recognise that there is a point there about the protection of allotment as a for growing food, that there is perhaps a need for flexibility, how we allow some of these plants to develop just to enable more people to access sites and also to cater for a variety of circumstances. Many people just want to do a little bit, really, and are also beginning and starting, and they don't want to be overwhelmed. So I think it's recognising that everybody's circumstances may be different is important as well. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Marie. I think that's happy with those responses, convener, and happy to let other colleagues come in now. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Willie. We're now going to move on to questions around the local food growing strategies with Paul McClellan.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Just to explore, as the convener said, about local food growing strategies, and I think one key thing that kind of came out in the papers we had was that the Community Growing Forum highlighted the fact that Part 9 of the Act aims to go just beyond addressing adequate allotment provision. And it's a quote here. It also aims to include wider community food growing opportunities, especially in areas of socio-economic disadvantage, and specifically in relation to food growing strategies. I know we've kind of all touched on it so far around about involvement. So I'm going to ask about the involvement of your own group in local food growing strategies with your local authority. And particularly around about just the point that was made there around about trying to include those who are experiencing socio-economic disadvantage. And Rosanna, I'll probably come to yourself. First of all, I know that the East Lothian Council has put together, because obviously it's my own constituency, has put together a local food growing network. And as we know, there are areas of poverty in the top 10% of SIMD in Trent and in Preston Pans. I just wondered what your involvement was in the local food growing strategy and your thoughts or discussions around about tackling or including those with socio-economic disadvantage.
Well, I've read it all. I think we, as I mentioned previously, we all help and we do have the food bank, we do have Home Start, but from them it was basically from the food bank joining our allotment, there was a discussion about health and wellbeing for the Forside area that I'm in for food poverty during the summer holidays, and from that we've now started, we're only going to have a second meeting, but we have, there's lots of community groups, there's a food bank, there's Home Start, there's Roots and Fruits, and we're actually all coming up with a programme to how to deal with food poverty during the summer holidays. So it's, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I've met the group's concern, so that I think it's a great initiative. In terms of your involvement with the council and the food growing strategy, do you want to say a bit more about that? Has there been a great amount of discussion, or is that something that could work a little bit better? Or?
There's been no discussion. I've read it. I've had no discussion with the council purely because we know that they don't have the manpower, and I think everybody involved in the area are quite happy. We've gone with it. We'll let the council know what we've decided with her. It's going to be called the Forside Food Fires, but so we're happy to go with that. We'll let the council know. We're not keeping the council out of it. We just appreciate they've got better things to do. We can do it. We're actually doing it. So
No, thanks. I think that's really helpful. Karen, I know you touched on a little bit around about your involvement and with the borders. I don't know if you want to touch any more on about that, just in terms of saying the food growing strategy, but also around about, you know, looking at it, the areas we've talked around about socio-economic disadvantage. If there's been any discussions or involvement in that regard.
I think when the council started to prepare the food growing strategy, I think we were quite critical because it is a community food growing strategy rather than a local food growing strategy. So it doesn't really involve other local producers in the food growing strategy. Having said that, though, from the development of the community food growing network, they have now facilitated a borders food growers network. And that's working really well. We've done education exchanges between groups. So, for example, Greener Peebles, who run the community growing initiative over in Peebles, we did a visit to their garden. They came to visit to our garden so we can share experience. So the Food Growers Network is helping what are a lot of organisations like our own, which are small organisations. They're helping us to build capacity as well. Abundant Borders started out as, at heart as a food insecurity charity. So we work on a circular basis. So we teach people how to grow food in a sustainable way. And then we teach people how to grow healthy and expensive meals from the food that they can grow or so source locally. And we base that in a community garden. So we're looking at that as a way of addressing some of the issues that you've outlined there. And I think the I'd say that the council has been really supportive in there, and we're working with the council and food housing associations, beg my pardon, in order to bring some smaller food growing initiatives into the hearts of places like Langley.
Ian, Maria, if you want to come in and just touch on the same points that I asked.
Yes, I'd like to add just Highland Council has just published their food growing strategy earlier this summer, and I think that it has been a very positive development because it's been accompanied by, you know, they've allocated a little bit of resource, they've got a project officer, and I think that is quite key really in terms of developing the area really, and even just that makes a huge difference to groups like ours, that the fact that they've really, to their credit, recognised the work we're doing, even though we don't yet have a site, I think has been really important for us. So I think I'd say, you know, that it is making a bit of an impact, and I think these things can help pave the way to make things better.
I mean, obviously, with Highlands itself, it's different to a lot of, I suppose, urban local authorities. Is there a rural poverty aspect to that at all? Just, you know, by the very scale sometimes, the Highlands, and has that been discussed at all?
Yeah, I don't. I think the way the strategy has been developed, it just covers a number of principles and examples. So I think they tackle a number of areas, and they see it more as an initiative that will facilitate activity rather than necessarily covering everything in depth. So it is there really as a reference to promote activity. I'd say that in terms of food poverty, it is an issue that is perhaps more hidden. I would say in our case, and I think, you know, the way to tackle this is not just with the strategies, but we need to really create spaces or initiatives that are close to those that need it really. And our own experience of being contacted by groups like Action for Children is that they do feel that having spaces that allow them to do activities close to where they are based, where they have the users, is important in terms of empowering some groups to be able to access food and feel that they have a choice over the food they consume and they grow. So I think it is important to highlight, you know, that's just an issue that needs to be tackled by thinking about where we've got the opportunities, really, where we place the sites.
Thanks, Nate. Ian, did you want to come in on that one at all?
In terms of that issue to do with social deprivation, what became clear to us over the period from 2005 up to when we were negotiating the introduction of the new legislation was that in terms of the self-generated allotment group activity exemplified by Eyemouth, Inverness, the Hawthorne site, all sorts of ones across the country, there was a noticeable lack of that kind of activity in the belt around Glasgow. Now, Glasgow is an exception because it had an existing network of allotments. So although there's waiting lists that have grown, there already was a reasonable amount of allotments in existence. whereas in many of the surrounding councils, in what you could describe as the post-industrial belt, there were not so many allotments or none at all, and there wasn't quite the same evidence of this self-generating group. And I think to some extent it's because people had become conditioned that, oh, the council does it. So if the council's not doing it, then it's not happening. And that's the exact opposite of what it seems to me community empowerment is about. Now, in recent times, there's been evidence of a more positive approach going on in the likes of North Lanarkshire, where there's been a number of new sites set up. They may have been more proactive in initiating the process. Renfrew Council, I used to attend their Growing Grounds forum meetings. I still get minutes from it. It has not really grown in terms of allotments. It's got more or less the same number of allotment sites as it had at the beginning, but they all look better than they did back in 2005-2006. I was involved up until a couple of years ago with North Ayrshire Food Forum, which was set up to address the issues to do with food poverty. And so it was a mixture of people from various groups involved in running food banks, other types of initiatives, and
Ian, I don't know if you can hear me. We just lost that last bit of your audio there. So not sure. No, we can't hear you. It was just the last little tail end. And I think what you gave us was very insightful. I think that was a new bit for me around there may not be more allotments, but actually the way in which they're being used has improved in that one place you were talking about. Paul, have you got
that's been really helpful. Thank you.
Yeah. OK, thanks very much. And now going to move on to questions from Marie McNair.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. It's great to see you all at the meeting this morning. I'm just going to touch on, just to explore the community organisations and volunteering part of it. The committee's kind of heard over, the committee's heard over the last few weeks about the importance of volunteering to successful community growing. How can local authorities help community growing and allotments to thrive in areas with lower levels of volunteering? I was going to direct this question to Ian. Now, Ian, I know you've touched on it a bit earlier, but I wonder if you'd like to add a bit more to it. I don't know if your sound is back on.
So maybe we start with Roseanne, sure. Because I feel like I've been hearing quite a lot of volunteering going on there from her.
So it makes me realise that in Tranent we're actually really lucky, and I hadn't fully appreciated till now. We have something called VCEL, Volunteer Centre East Lothian. So if you want volunteers, you just go and ask them and they'll put something out for you. But also within our community groups, we've got the criminal justice team. So if we need anything done, any work, not just for the community groups, but for us, they'll do it for us. And also, well, obviously, the out school, they have lots of volunteers that will help. New Beginnings have lots of volunteers, as does Home Start. And even individual plot holders will help the other areas if they want, you know, even just cleaning out a plot that's overgrown. So we have a good access to volunteers. We probably don't use a lot because we don't need them, because of the amount of volunteers we have already in the allotment. So we are really quite lucky.
Yeah, picked it up. Is there anything that East Lothian Council could do a bit more of or be better at that would assist your group?
No. We're quite lucky that the person that I deal with most of the groups that I'm involved with, he just lets us run. He, you know, he'll give us what support we need, and if I need to ask for anything, he's there. But he just lets us run because we are all quite, we know what to do. So I don't think, I'm just thinking from it, there's nothing more they could actually do to help us, because, you know, they're letting us do, they're there if we need them.
Thank you. I'll pop that out to the rest of the panel. Karen or Maria, would you like to kind of add anything further to what's been said?
I think it goes back for us, it goes back to what Maria said, and having the ability to do community growing, and so the ability to volunteer actually close to people where they need it. So that's why we've taken the view that we have small community growing spaces, so we can have, it can be a very small piece that's right outside of, we work quite closely with Berwickshire Housing Association, and so they now routinely leave a small piece of land that is then available for community growing. So we don't think, even though we are turning people who come and use the garden as volunteers, because they do come in and volunteer, and they're digging the beds and they're growing the vegetables and all that kind of thing, we think of them more as community food growers. So they're not volunteering in the sort of traditional sense of volunteering and coming in and helping Abundant Borders to do something. I mean, we have the same sort of links with the criminal justice team if we need paths laid and big infrastructure projects. But the volunteers are the people who come in and grow food for themselves and for their family. So we look at it in a slightly different way. But the key is that it's that community engagement and community involvement, because the community growing space is right at the heart of their community.
Maria?
Yes, I think I was going to touch on a different point that is not about as much about the role, but the need for land or spaces where we can take forward that community activity. I would say, you know, one of the issues we've got with Inverness, it's a fast-growing city. We've got brick and mortar everywhere, and there isn't really always the recognition given to the fact that you need community spaces for people to be able to develop that sense of community, really. And I think it's important that this is at the heart of how you plan your communities, really, that you allocate spaces that can be used for food growing and maybe green space as well, as a key element of any new area that has been planned, really. So that that facility, that is what allows people to really bring together, bring the communities together. And then once you've got those spaces, people will naturally volunteer. So it's not, I think, difficult to see that happening. And we know that is key, because we see that in other parts of Inverness, where there is a real desire, for example, in areas like Crown, to develop more community activities, but there is no space. And I think that it's important to recognise that it is an issue as well of land availability, making land available for community food growing and green spaces. So thank you.
You certainly preempted my second question. Can I just put a further question to you? Should community gardens have the same legislation as allotments currently do?
Yeah, I would say that it's interesting. Our project, really, and this came from the community consultation we did, it doesn't just cover allotments, but it aims to develop a communal areas for food growing and a community, and a wider, more commercial community growing area, and also have areas for recreation. I think there is an orchard, really. I think there is an increasing wider perspective of how we see these spaces, and the fact that they need to be more than just an allotment. I think this is important in terms of bringing the legislation up to date with how we use these spaces and how we what society's needs are. So I would say that there's certainly a wider vision, and I think there's a lot of interesting projects out there that show what it's possible to do, and certainly the more communal model is also, I think, being taken forward in different places. I think it is certainly something I would support.
Thank you. Karen, what's your view on my question about community gardens having the same protection in legislation as allotments?
I think because it's more about green spaces and providing those community spaces, and I think our view really is that the community to be able to decide themselves how they want to use that space. So we encourage community food growing within the spaces that we support within communities. But it's also important that they are spaces that people can just meet and that the community can develop that. So I'm not sure how you would protect that in legislation particularly, but I think if, as they have done down in Scottish Borders Council, you have a sort of focus on being able to make more green spaces available and for the council to be looking very carefully at how it uses space and how it can release more space. And as I say, we've got really good links with all of three of the major housing associations down here in the Scottish Borders, and they manage a lot of space. And they also, it can be an issue if they have communal space that is being neglected. So I think it's more of a partnership approach than a legislation approach, I think, because the uses, that you know, the sizes are so different and the uses are so different. I'm not really sure how that would go into legislation to protect that.
Thanks, Karen. That's myself.
Thanks, Marie. I think Ian wanted to come in on that question as well. Yep, come on in, Ian. Hopefully, we can hear.
I lost sound and picture for a while there, so I didn't get all of that quick. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. I missed what the question was because I seem to have been cut off.
I was just asking about, you know, should community gardens have the same protection in legislation as allotments currently do?
Well, that's, I would think that there are a number of organisations around. I was involved with the Allotment Regeneration Initiative that I referred to. That was a project that was managed through the then Federation of City Farms and Community Gardens, now called Social Farms and Gardens. So they're a representative body for people involved in that kind of activity, as indeed they have some allotment sites that join them. Equally, there could be, we considered in Scottish allotments, since our acronym name was STAGS, could become Scottish Allotments and Growing Spaces. My own thought on that at the moment is, unfortunately, I'll be repeating what I've already said, is that the allotment is defined in law, and at the moment, the growing space is not. Now, again, I'd have to refer back to why we have these views about this and its history. The fact that 90% of the allotments in Scotland disappeared. And my own memory of an allotment is going up Crow Road in Glasgow on a gadget my dad fitted on the front of his bike, to the allotment that my mother had looked after during the war on what is now part of Annie's Land College. So a lot of people's experience and involvement comes from their early life. And of course, that's where the break has been. Fewer allotments around, less people have it as part of their life experience with all the things that come with that. I think in terms of the legislation, it would have to be down to those that are involved in it to take up that issue, to have it defined in law if that's what they wanted. So there are bodies like Social Farms and Gardens that they could become part of that might provide the impetus. They have lots of experience in terms of campaigning and funding.
That's my questions covered. Good evening, thank you.
Thanks, Marie. I'm going to just pick up a couple of other questions. One of them is around the whole relationship with planning, and maybe it's not a question that's relevant to everybody in the group, but I think some of you may have had this kind of experience and done this work, and if you haven't, that's fine. But I'm curious to hear how communities can use local place plans to ensure local authorities include community growing in the local authority development plans, and to hear your views in general how the planning system could be better used to ensure adequate provision is made for new and existing community growers. So it's quite a lot, but just in general, it's that local place plan piece. Anybody want to come in on that? Ian?
I thought, can you hear me? I keep getting a signal on my screen.
We can hear you.
Right, okay. I think it was 2019, the last time we actually had our annual conference, and we presented this booklet, Plan to Grow, It was drawn up for us by Stephen Tolson, who's a planner. It was arrived at by holding a series of seminars with the assistance of Planning Aid Scotland to come up with a series of proposals and guidelines to do with the provision of allotments and community growing spaces. There's a larger report. Both of these are on the Scottish Allotments website, or should be. And one of the things I asked Stephen was whether he thought it was worthwhile having follow-up sessions for the planners, because it was directed at the planners. And he reckoned yes. I don't know if anything's taken place. It's another one of those things where it takes a bit of funding input in order to get it on the way. My own experience in relating to planning came from, again, going back to 2005 up to 2008, when there was all these new groups coming in. And the biggest pressure against any potential bits of ground that were identified anywhere to be developed was it was being sat on because of its potential for private house development, until the financial recession of 2008 kind of brought that to an end. Unfortunately, there is another and perhaps more important need that has an input into planning, and that is the need for social and affordable housing. And what we've got to try and avoid is a repeat of what happened after the war, when lots of allotments, certainly in Glasgow that I know of, disappeared in order to provide better housing for people. It was a clear need. I benefited from it myself. But we also made lots of mistakes in creating all these big housing areas with little other type of provision as part of it. And some of them, I know certainly in Glasgow, have ended up being knocked down. I don't know what they've been replaced with. But hopefully when they are replaced, planning will ensure that there will be the incorporation into it of spaces for people to grow.
Thank you for that. Yes, I think there's certainly an interesting and invitation and challenge to planners around how we can provide housing with gardens, with growing spaces there. So, Maria, you would like to come in, and then Karen.
Yes, I'd say there isn't perhaps the importance given to these spaces in the planning decision-making process. I'd say, you know, you normally, when you think about an allotment site, you say, oh, well, that land that nobody else wants, and it's sort of far away, could be the allotment site, you know, rather than giving it the, you know, thinking about, well, where is it that people will want, will be able to walk to, will be able to actually, without having to use the car, will be able to provide and get the what they need. So I'd say it's really, you know, needs a bit of a mindset change to be able to approach this in the right way. For example, just to give you an example of the field we are looking at acquiring is within walking distance of six schools and 20 minutes walk from some of the more deprived areas. So it's a site that could be at the heart of the town and many people, and it's easily accessible for many. So it's quite an obvious place to, and it's good agricultural land. And I think it's about thinking really about where we need to, where is the ideal place and location for these places, rather than just thinking as an afterthought, what bit of land nobody else wants, and we'll put that to allotments. It's important to plan these sites so they fulfill the whole purpose. And I don't think we are yet quite at the stage where this is fully recognised in the planning decision making. So while there is, I think, an intention, and we see that in the as local development plans are developing, of you know, they're developing this sense of place, this communities of living close to each other, I think it is still quite a challenge to get the decisions to be made in the right way when it comes to reality. So I do feel that the, you know, the planning system, there's not yet a culture in terms of allowing making the decisions in the right way. Thank you.
Thanks, Maria. And Karen?
I think there is movement in the right direction down in the borders, as I say, with the sort of green spaces team and actually that mapping exercise, because there have been a couple of incidents we've had recently where housing association has thought they owned a piece of land within the housing development, and it's turned out it's still been owned by the Borders Council, and then that the sort of process of who actually owns the land and it is not always clear. And I think once that's identified, the procedure to have a community asset transfer needs to be simplified. We have a group who have just created allotments and community garden blended space, and it took many years to get that asset transferred from Transport Scotland. And that would seem to be because there was a mismatch between what was in the community empowerment, so making sure that land could be transferred to the community at a reasonable price, and also a separate requirement from Transport Scotland to get maximum value from that piece of land. So I think a lot of that needs to be simplified to make it easier for communities to be able to purchase land and for land to be able to come back into community use quite quickly. But again, it's working quite well here because of that enhanced partnership working. So the benefit is now seen to be seen. So for example, the community garden that we support in Duns was on the piece of land that all of the building contractors parked on and all the equipment was housed in while the housing development was being built. So it wasn't prime food growing land, but it was bare land that was left once the house had been built, because the last thing offers are porta cabins. So, you know, again, it's a case of being creative about the space that might be there once the development has been completed, as well as putting that into the plan in the first place.
Thank you both for those contributions. That's really helpful. I want to just pick up on another question, which is around funding. So I'm interested to hear whether your projects, whether community growing projects and allotment association have access to grants and other forms of funding. We want to know who the big funders are. Maybe that's so we can apply ourselves. And what role does the Scottish Government have in this kind of funding space? So I would say that this is maybe a question that's directed to, let's start with Karen and then see who else wants to pick it up.
We are funded for most of our activities through the Robertson Trust and through National Lottery Community Fund. My big issue across all of the different things we do is that, particularly from the Scottish Government, there is always a driver when you're applying for funding for it to be a new project. So if you have a successful community food growing project that is successfully delivering food to the local community and addressing all of those sort of issues of social isolation, food insecurity, and it's running and doing really well, it's then difficult to attract funding for anything other than a new project. So this constant driver to come up with a new thing creates a real burden in administration for the small organisations like our own. So to have an acknowledgement that this, that community food growing in however, you know, all of us on the panel today do it in slightly different ways, but are all successful in our own way, in the way we do it within our own communities. So to have an acknowledgement that this is a really vital thing that we're all doing, that growing, teaching people to grow food and allowing people to grow food is important and will be increasingly important with the cost of living crisis, with climate change, with all these sort of drivers. It's really important that that community food growing is acknowledged as something that might be worthy of core support rather than this constant driver for okay, well, you did that last year, but what new thing are you going to do this year? So that's it. Yeah, that's how I think it could be helped, because we're constantly looking for project funding rather than the acknowledgement that this is a really vital thing that we're all doing.
Thanks very much, Karen. And just you mentioned large infrastructure projects. So just before Maria comes in, I just wanted to touch in. So with your large scale infrastructure projects, is that where you get you get that funding from the Robertson's Trust and the National Lottery Community Fund for those?
No, the National Lottery Community Fund, it's through their social isolation strand. It's actually not through, it's not the importance of the growing food particularly. It's getting people into a community setting, and we're growing food as part of that. So the National Lottery funding is through tackling social isolation, and the Robertson funding, actually contrary to what I just said, is actually acknowledgement that what we've done for the past 3 years has been really successful and really valuable. And they've given us core funding for a further 3 years, but that isn't typical. It's mainly that we're having to go for small amounts of grants all the time. So for example, we're putting up a community pavilion in Dunn's, an outdoor classroom. So that was separately funded from Borders Council. We're looking to put a polytunnel in Eyemouth. That was separately funded from a different funding stream. So it's constantly these small amounts of funding to fund small things, rather than have the project overall funded to be able to allow us to deliver across the whole region.
Yeah, thanks for that. And that's quite time consuming, putting all these pieces together. Maria, you wanted to come in on this as well.
Yeah, it was a slightly different aspect, really. And I think because we are following the Community Empowerment Act as an asset transfer request, we are on a different experience, yet we haven't quite got to the implementation stage. But I did want to highlight and commend you the role that the Scottish Land Fund plays in supporting these asset transfers, really, in terms of we were able to get stage one funding that allows us to carry on that feasibility study and design, and that's been really helpful and allowed us really to step up our work and develop the group as well. And we are sort of looking at trying to access funds to purchase the site. And I would like to sort of, commend as well Highlands and Islands Enterprise for the way they run the fund in a very supportive way to community groups. And I think that's a good model, really, in terms of facilitating and helping communities through the process. And I know this is not quite, we're not quite at the stage yet of taking the process, the project on the ground, but I think it's worth highlighting that for the benefit of the committee. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for that, because I think it does show us that there's in a way you're the group that Ian's talked about, the group of people that have come together and are trying to do the community empowered piece of work, and even there you can see that you've got quite a lot of hurdles that you've had to jump over over the years that you've been working on this. Roseanne, did you want to come in on funding for your project?
Yeah, we rent from the council, and we're allowed to set our own rents ourselves, which we do. We have received funding from the Area Partnership, and I think it was the Scottish Government, a fund for something, but we recently got money from the Scottish Government Mental Health Fund. We applied for that, so we've got funding for there, so we can buy things like tools. So we've been quite lucky with what the funding we've got, which has kept us going. But we, as I say, what helps us is we set our own rent, and we've agreed that every year it goes up by £2. So, yeah.
Great. Okay. Well, I think that's we've come to the end of our questions. I think, Ian, you want to come in too?
Briefly, the site I am on is independent. It was put under threat before the war by a housing development. That spurred the then members to acquire the land, which they've done successfully in the late 40s, early 50s. So we sustain ourselves. Similar to what Roseanne described, we set our own rents at our annual general meeting, And we augment that with an annual open day where the proceeds go into our general funds and allow us to operate and pay for the things that we need to do. We have electricity and water to pay for and repairs over the years. And that's one of the, and if you can set up self-managing allotment sites within the local councils or the other arrangements that are around, then the only real funding that's needed in any big sense is at the beginning to put in the infrastructure, because we've got 10,000 or thereabouts existing plots. We seem to have, certainly in the main cities, another 10,000 people looking for an allotment or something of that nature. So that's going to acquire new land, hopefully suitable land. I've been interested in the descriptions of what some people get offered. As a retired gardener, to put it no more sophisticatedly than that, I am puzzled by why it is people seem to think that the best thing to grow food on is raised beds on crushed rubble or something of that nature. To get the best results, you want to be on reasonable quality soil. Soil is the main asset that needs to be looked after.
Thank you for that response, Ian. And I think you're absolutely right. Starting off with good soil is a very good beginning. Having started a project on sand myself at one point in the not too distant past, but you were mentioning things like, you set the rent at a self-sustaining rate, but you have, you have ongoing costs from, one year to another. And one of the things that's come up to us is Scottish Water. How do you find the cost of paying for your water? I'd love to hear a little bit about that.
I gave up the treasurer's post back in 2012, I think it was. So I'm not absolutely up to speed. We've got an AGM in a fortnight. We'll no doubt get a statement of what we're currently paying. Our water supply is metered. So we simply pay the bills as they come in via the association account. All that will happen is going to happen in a fortnight's time, as we've not, obviously, with COVID, had our open days. So our only revenue is the rent. And we haven't had an AGM to reset the rent if they deemed that necessary. And so we get a financial statement. We look at it. We see what our outgoings are. We pay honorarium to our main office bearers, secretary, treasurer, and the person that looks after the sort of general grounds out with the actual plots themselves. And so we have to take all of that into account. Our main utility bills is electricity and water. Now, so I'm not aware whether there's a current specific significant price rise in the offing. It's just one of these things we will need to look at when we set our rents and whether we're going to try and have an open day again. Because the value of the open day beyond bringing in revenue is it's another way by which we link to the local community. And that's always an important thing. An allotment site shouldn't be an island exclusive to its members and no one else. It should relate to the local community in which it sits.
Okay, I think that's a really nice place to end with the comment around the open day and that allotments shouldn't be an island and they should connect to their local and surrounding community. And that kind of brings in the point that Maria is saying, is that we actually want to see sites that are accessible to six schools and people be able to walk to them easily and get growing in and following that impulse. So thanks so much for joining us this morning. I think it's been really useful discussion to hear from you. I think it's added another layer to the conversation we had over the last few weeks. And as that's the last public item on our agenda for today, I now close the public meeting.